You know, God has prepared a place for us in heaven for those who believe. And this residence or the home you live in, as nice as it is, as beautiful as it is, the place that the Lord constructs for you once you believe is magnificent. And there are people who've been there that will tell you nothing that you see on earth will compare with forever. And so Jesus tells his disciples these famous words in the Gospel of John chapter 14, because they're concerned that his conversation is implying that he's going to be leaving. Now listen to his words, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me, for in my Father's house are many rooms." Another translation says many mansions. "And if it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." And Thomas, the doubting disciple, there's always one of them, right? "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Eternal life and heaven is only accessed through faith in Christ. By grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone. Not through good works, not effort, not through any other religious icon. But Scripture is clear. It's through faith in Jesus." And Jesus says he's going to prepare a place for us. I think it's interesting that Jesus on earth was a carpenter. People, a person in the construction industry, all the people in the construction industry say it. Wow, I heard some women in there. That's pretty impressive. That's stout. So I think that when you look at this passage, and people who've been to heaven and returned will corroborate this, that based on how we live on earth, once we believe in Christ, he is actually constructing our home. You realize that in heaven we live in homes. We don't float on clouds. All right? We don't sprout wings, live in a treehouse, all right, and float on proverbial white, pristine clouds. We actually live in homes. And Jesus is building the place called your home or your mansion in heaven as we speak. Once we come to Christ, that process begins. And he's prepared a place in a future home, a forever home, once we put our faith in Christ and begin to follow him. In 2013, I had the great pleasure of spending time with a man named Don Piper, a former pastor. Don Piper, because of a horrific car accident, actually died for 90 minutes and went to heaven, out of which came the New York Times best-selling book, 90 Minutes in Heaven. He was dead, and he was good and dead. The movie was made out of that book 3 years ago, starring Hayden Christensen, the lead actor in Star Wars, and Kate Bosworth as his wife. The movie was a hit. The gospel went throughout the world because no one could deny that someone who had come back to life after being dead an hour and a half could be disbelieved. Well, there was a follow-up interview, and there were many of them, but I chose this one to revisit that moment. Take a look.
On a lonely Texas highway back in 1989, Don Piper saw two things in quick succession. First, a big rig headed straight for his car, and then the gates of heaven.
In 1989, Don Piper was instantly killed when his Ford Escort was crushed in a head-on collision. Paramedics covered his mangled body with a tarp. Then a pastor stopped and asked paramedics if he could pray for Don.
I walked over by the door, great physical damage on the outside, and I laid my hands on him and began to pray for him.
As the pastor knelt over Don's body, a sound came from beneath the tarp. Don wasn't dead.
And joining us now is a man who likes to say he's back by popular demand, Don Piper. Well, back by popular demand because of all the people that were praying for you. Don, it's good to see you. Walk us through what happened that day.
Well, I'm honored to be here very much. Thank you. People prayed, and I lived. I was on my way to church to teach a Bible study on a Wednesday, and the 18-wheeler crossed the center stripe and hit me on this rural bridge in the middle of nowhere, and word reached my church that I had been in an accident, but not that I was a fatality, because my family had not been notified. They started praying. Mm. One of the pastors who was with the same conference with me was behind me. He came upon the accident, and God spoke to him and said, pray for the man in the red car, which was me. Mm. He got permission to get in the car, prayed for me. And as he's praying over my dead body, 90 minutes after the truck hit me and killed me, he's singing the great hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, over my dead body. I've been dead an hour and a half, and suddenly, as he sings it, I start singing it with him. And he got out of the car really fast.
I bet.
He did, yeah. And told everybody I was alive.
And when I was reading it in your book, they didn't really believe him at first.
No, they thought it was his imagination, because yeah. Four paramedics had pronounced me dead.
Four.
And they were waiting for the coroner, obviously, to come and take the body away. And so everyone, to say the least, was stunned by this turn of events. Then they had to figure out how to get me out of that horrific mashed car and to take me to a hospital.
Now, before you started singing with the pastor, you were in heaven.
I
had gone to the gates of heaven. Tell us about that.
Well, of course, there are 12 of them. There's three on each side of the city, the four walls of the city. It was magnificent. It really was a gate made of pearl. I wouldn't have believed this could happen until it happened to me.
And you think this was a real visitation?
Oh, it was.
Not something your body was just...
More real than anything I've experienced since. And, mm-hmm. and when I came back, of course, I had 34 operations, was in a hospital for 13 months. That was real. But heaven's more real than that. The emotions, the feeling, the reality of being with the people who had preceded me in death.
Who was the first person that you saw and recognized?
My grandfather. Mm-hmm. I had been with him when he died. We were very, very close. I just adored him. And he died tragically of a heart attack one night, and I rode in the ambulance with him.
Wow.
So I was devastated when I lost him, and he was there to greet me when I died here. He was the first person I saw, and he looked good. You want to look good, heaven is where you want to be. He extended his hands to me, and he was missing fingers here on earth.
Mm.
And I looked down at the hands that held me when I was a little boy, and all of his fingers were there.
Wow.
And he said, in a language I've never heard before but fully understood, welcome home, Donnie, which is what he called me when I was here. I knew where I was when I saw him.
And you said you saw another lady, I don't remember the relation, but she, in real life she didn't have teeth, but in heaven she had the most gorgeous smile you'd ever seen.
It was my great-grandmother, yes. She had osteoporosis. She was very stooped as a result of her bones having collapsed. She was a good 6 inches taller in heaven, and... she smiled at me with her real smile. I'd never seen it before. She had dentures, and she didn't wear them very often.
That's amazing. Well, you talk about the music and the colors and the sounds and the love that you felt in heaven was something that you said was hard to write about in a book because there really aren't any human words to describe.
We don't have earthly words here to describe heaven. And many have taken a shot at it and done a good job of talking how glorious heaven is, but really think it's... It's heaven. It's not here, and it's not like here. The best thing about heaven, beyond the colors and the aromas and the music and the angels and all those, is you're with God. You are with God, and we will be His people, and He will be with us forever.
Forever. So with us, this is us. So when he went to heaven, he saw the us of his family that had believed in Jesus that were there. He said, the ones that greet you are the loved ones you've lost. And secondly, the ones you've led to Christ or had an impact on their lives. Four paramedics, he was dead for 90 minutes. Of course, the movie is now history. Hayden Christensen, Kate Bosworth played the lead roles. And when I talked to him, one of the reasons he said, you know, you ask yourself, how does something like that happen? My arm's in the back seat. And he said, when I was in heaven, there was no pain. I had a perfect physique, which I'm into, by the way. But he didn't want to come back. He said, you never want to come back. You hear this from people who've been there. God allows them to have a preview, a glimpse of forever and eternity. And he told me, Norman, I didn't want to come back, but the Lord made it clear that there was a unique place not only in heaven for him, but that there was a unique place and purpose for him on earth that he hadn't finished yet. And so because of that, against his will, the Lord sent him back. In heaven, he said, I had no pain. As soon as my spirit reentered my body, I had immense, intense pain. 34 surgeries would be required. And he was, for two years, he said, I went dark and I became very depressed and I shook my fist at God and I said, You let me taste of the reality of heaven, and now you've put me back in the pain of this earth. God, why? It's the proverbial theological question. Why suffering? Especially when you've tasted of eternity and forever. The Lord pretty much, let me summarize what he said. He was going to plant a church in a local community, but God's plan for him was to be a global missionary. Little did he know that he would go through an excruciating, crucifying experience. And with the credibility of that suffering, to this day, Don Piper, with his beautiful bride, who has an incredible story of her own and nursing him back to health, have traversed the globe. He takes no money for any appearance because he says it would be like prostituting my journey into eternity. And he says he gives all of it away to humanitarian needs. And he continues to do that, just living on what he needs for he and his wife to live on. And he continues to do that. And he told me this, Norman, I'll come back for free. I like this church. Because when he came, a number of people, and some of you perhaps, found Jesus because of his story. And when we say God has more, sometimes we get so caught up in today and the suffering and the daily grind and the challenges that are necessary for us to live, we forget there's more, as the worship team sang, and more, and there's not just today, there's tomorrow, there's the day after tomorrow, isn't that true? And there's always a season. When one season sets, another one dawns. And some of you are in that place right now. Don Piper told me, he says, I realized God wanted to redirect me into my actual purpose for the next season of my life, that this is why I'm on the planet. My question to you is, in the context of eternity, do you know why you're on this earth? What on earth, as the great Rick Warren would say, are you here for? Because it will play out into all of eternity forever. His promises are forever. The place he has for you and I is forever and ever. It's not just for today. Now, Scripture is clear that we are not saved. Our eternity is not secure. We don't come to God's forgiveness and redemption through works. We don't work it up. We don't try to gain God's approval through our behavior. There's nothing that we can do to fulfill God's perfect standard on this earth or pay the price for the sins we've committed or the nature we've been born with. That's why God sent his only son to be a savior. However, while he prepares a place for us in heaven, once we believe in him, God has prepared works for us to achieve once we believe. We're not saved to sit. We are saved to serve. And Don Piper's serving direction had to be recalibrated from his will into God's will. Unfortunately, it took such a drastic experience to do so. Scripture says here in Ephesians chapter 2, the great apostle Paul, for by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, his masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works. We are not saved by good works. Okay, we don't serve our way into salvation. We believe our way into salvation. However, once we're saved for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Don Piper is walking into his good works right now. Financially giving away the proceeds from the book and the movie, and just living on what he needs, and speaking and teaching, counseling and praying for the sick. How's that? And he's doing it in many nations of the planet. It's his purpose. Having gone to heaven, he's trying to bring heaven to earth. And we get to do that, folks, in everything that we say and we do. There's a preordained set of good works that we are to execute through our serving. And one day we're going to stand before the Lord to give account for that. Scripture says this, 1 Peter, as each has received the gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks is one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves is one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. When I came to the Lord, back in late 1973, ouch, that's a pretty long time ago, I came into a church and it was like, I was very different. I had long hair, everybody had short hair, now everybody got all kind of hair. Some people have no hair. And I said, I didn't grow up in church. I felt very different. I felt inferior and everything. And so there's two things that I did. For the first 6 years, I cleaned the church restrooms with these two hands. In scripture, hands speak of service, worship, and serving. So I did that, and they found out I played the drums professionally, and so I began to play the drums. The problem was, as I've said to you before, nobody was playing the drums in church. And so when I began to play the drums with worship music, everyone stared at me, and the older half the church didn't like it. They thought it was demonic. They said, rock music in the church, those rhythms create lust in people, and they want to have sex and all this. And this is what I was told. And they put the drums right in the middle. But there was the music director who believed in my gift. Well, now everybody has drums. They said in Hawaii that I was the first one. I don't know if I was. Now everybody has drummers, and they put them in the cave, and they hide them. Which to me is heaven, because I'm going to play again, okay, one day. And I'm going to put a microwave, a television. I'm going to put my favorite pictures and everything in there, and you won't be able to tell. I'll put, have food on the side and everything. So heaven in the drum cave. But those are the two things I did. That's all I did. Then I became a small group leader. But there's something that God's placed in your hands. There's a set of gifts, talents, and abilities that he wants you to use. Because once you're saved, once you believe and you've secured your home in heaven, the Lord requires of us that we serve. We are saved to serve, not saved to sit. We are here to make a difference in the lives of other people. And he will do anything to redirect us into our purpose. And sometimes, if we're not listening, something very extreme. That's not what I'm saying happened to Don Piper, okay? But I'm saying there are these mysteries of pain and suffering that God allows to reflect his glory. Now, let me close with this today. Understand that all of us are going to appear, every one of us, I don't know how this is going to happen, at the end of time and individually stand before the Lord to give account for how we've served with what we've been given. Think about that. See, one of the reasons I want to play again is I feel in me rhythms that haven't been used up. There's something in the basement still that needs to be expressed before I see Jesus. Okay? Some of you are going, you actually play the drums? Yeah. Yeah, trust me. And there's more to that. Now, I don't know what's in your basement. What's still there that needs to come out through your hands, because hands speak of worship and service. Don't let fear or comparison or past failure keep you from serving him to glorify him. Because understand that one day, no matter what other people thought, because people said a lot of nasty things about me when I started playing the drums in church at a time that wasn't done. I remember coming in just seeing the Hammond organ, the lady with the tambourine. It's like the tambourines have always existed, all right? I just realized this was going to break ground. I didn't realize what groundbreaking impact it would have statewide, perhaps even on the mainland, I don't know. But I can confidently stand before the Lord one day knowing that, Lord, the gifts that you gave this Asian guy to have black funky rhythm, I used. And I did it to worship you. So there's some worship in here that needs to be left. I think I'm done cleaning toilets, though. 6 years was enough. And that's why when I go into the toilet, to this day, the restrooms, the men's restroom, of course, although sometimes I made a mistake because of a lack of direction. I want to say to you, men, don't miss. And if you miss, wipe up. Wax on, wax off. Pastor Paris and I used to wax the toilets at Grace Bible Church Honolulu. We would shine the chrome. We would polish the porcelain. We would make sure everything was spitty and shiny. And so today, when I go into the restrooms, I appreciate those who serve by cleaning the restroom. I did that for 6 years, and I played that for 6 years. No, I played that for 20 years. What do you have that you can serve with, knowing you're going to stand before God? Because he'll reward those who embrace the work of their God-given purpose. Look at this. The great apostle gives us Paul gives us a glimpse into the future. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Now, the great apostle Paul had to fight tremendous condemnation and guilt, because before he became a Christ follower and put his faith in Jesus, his authority put Christians in prison and sometimes to death. He was a terrorist before that term was ever coined. And so when he came to faith in Christ, he had to battle in tremendous guilt over his past. But his faith in Christ and his focus on the prize of forever pulled him out of his past and actually put him in prison for 5 years. Off and on, over a long ministry career, this one-time terrorist, while he was in prison, which was frustrating for him, because he was a real activist guy, in those 5 years, God allowed him to go to prison so he could write scripture. Half the New Testament, almost half the New Testament, is scripture we have, the canon of scripture that we have, because Paul was in prison and he could do nothing else but write. What you think is a prison might be a place where God says, here's how I want you to serve and where I want you to serve. Don Piper was in the prison of his body while God was working deeply in him the messages that today he takes to the nations of the earth that has become a movie. And the gospel has gone viral. I believe when he stands before the Lord one day, God will say, Don, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. It is said, some people say it there at their funerals or at the end of life, you know, here's how I want to live because this is what I want people to say about me. You know what's more important? Here's how I want to live, so because I want, this is what I would want, what God would say about me. I would want God to say about me that I fulfilled his purpose that was crafted from before the foundations of the earth. I fulfilled my why for being alive. And about you, at my age now, I evaluate that all the time. I said, Lord, I see more behind me that's what's in front of me. But as I pastor this church and what's time that's left, I want to teach and preach and train in a way they see forever past today. That they see the future. And that the prize of tomorrow will pull you out of the pain of your past. I think that that is so very important. Paul said, therefore, one thing I do. He says, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, that if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. Paul said, I've got to strain to break through the guilt of my past, and therefore, I can't be looking in the rearview mirror. I've got to look at what's ahead in the future, and I'm keeping my eyes on the prize of forever. My focus on the prize must trump my focus on the past, because as far as Jesus is concerned, it's under the blood, forgiven and forgotten. And some of us may be in that place today. You see, you don't know where I've been and what I've done, but coming to Christ and saying, Lord, I believe, forgive me, I surrender, wipes it all away as if it never happened. And that can happen on a daily basis. You're always looking ahead. We're here to please and glorify him. And if you're already saved, and you know you put your faith in Christ, and you know God has already crafted a place for you in forever, in eternity, and Don Piper will attest to that. And by the way, some of the accounts is that as you tour heaven, you can see like going into a new subdivision. Some homes are half built. Some homes are fully built and inhabited by people who have gone before him. And some homes are only beginning to be built. And here's the deal. He says, the homes are built according to the faithful service of believers. I don't know about you, but that makes me want to live on point and not fuss for myself. It makes me want to live for us, not just for me. Because this is us. And when you go to heaven, it's going to be a whole lot of us. There's going to be a whole lot of us over there. In fact, you're going to go, man, you're part of us? I thought you was in the other place. This is us, baby. And when you get there, it's going to be forever and ever and ever and ever. Forever. Forever is a very long time. Great reunion. You see the rest of your us if they put their faith in Christ, and only if put their faith in Christ, because we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone, not by works. But once we believe, there are works for us to achieve, and the Lord says, one day I'm going to measure that. Did you fulfill the reason for which you're on the planet? And it comes down to, I got to play that again to back up the guys that are going to take over the church, hide in the cave so nobody sees me, and play rhythms that will take you into heaven. I got a secret to tell you as I close today. When I was in the 8th and 9th grade, and don't tell anybody this, I didn't play sports at Kalakaua School. Well, I did, but I warmed the bench. I didn't play in the band, which Kalakaua had a kicking band. Kalakaua School had 2,000 people in it. But I played in the orchestra. All the nerdy people played in the orchestra. Nerdy. First of all, if you're in Kalihi, don't play in the orchestra, okay? Because they'll make fun of you. And I played, of all instruments, the string bass. You know the stand-up bass? I played with a guy named Aaron Mahi and Lee Barrett. And these are two big guys, big Hawaiian guys. And then there was me. And the string bass towering way over that. I also was playing in a rock band. We were playing stuff like Young Rascals, Strawberry Alarm Clock, who's that? Spencer Davis Group, Cream, things like that. But when I played the string bass, there was one song that really riveted my soul. Because it had this wicked kind of drum and bass line. I used to really get off on that time, the bow, you know what I mean? You're holding the thing. Yeah, I know, you guys are going, you played bass too, champ, you lying, okay? Hey, looks are deceiving. Well, Stanley Kaichi was the intermediate school teacher, and he told us about this guy. He said, this song was written by a guy named George Frederick Handel. And so let me read you the description to summarize what he said. To call George Frederick Handel one of history's greatest composers is an understatement. Even Beethoven, the great Beethoven. You guys know who Beethoven is? How many know who Beethoven? Not the dog in the movie, okay? Beethoven, the great musical genius composer. Beethoven said to him, to Handel, I bow my knee. He wrote 42 operas, 29 oratorios. I know you don't know what that means. 120 cantatas. But at the age of 56, he felt he was done. He was depressed. He was in debt because Handel would make a habit of giving money from his music away to the suffering, the poor, and the orphan. But he sustained a stroke, which debilitated one side of his body. Handel was a composer, a conductor, a musician, and a writer. He needed especially his right hand, which he could no longer use. Thinking he was done, Handel, who was a strong ardent Christ follower, dug deep. And you know, sometimes you ask God the questions, why? Like Don Piper did. Why? God, this is my best gift. How can I use it? Paul probably asked that question in prison, and God used his hands to write. Maybe some of you feel that way. Well, on August 21st, 1741, Handel started composing for the next 3 weeks. He got focused. He rarely left his composing chair, and 21 days later, he would emerge with perhaps the most performed piece of music in Western history, a 260-page composition called The Messiah. Handel's Messiah. On the last page, he wrote the initials SDG, standing for Sole Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory. The Messiah debuted on April 13, 1742, as a benefit concert. It raised £400, and those £400 were used to set free 142 men who were in a debtor's prison. That's the tip of the iceberg. In his will, Handel left the Messiah and all the money it would make for poverty to Foundling Hospital in London because Handel wasn't a musician who happened to follow Christ. He was a Christ follower who happened to write music. Music was his passion, but the gospel was his mission. He knew it was his calling to set the captives free and to care for the sick through the gift of his composition and musicianship. It wasn't just music, it was a movement. One of Handel's biographers said that the Messiah has fed the hungry, clothed the naked, fostered the orphan more than any other musical production. Musicologist Percy Young said, no other composer has so largely contributed over centuries to the relief of human suffering. It is said that when Handel was writing in the midst of his depression and pain, God gave him a vision of heaven. And the vision of heaven caused the notes to become legendary. This past Easter, on Good Friday and Easter, all over the world, the great classic, Handel's Messiah, was performed. This was one of those moments. And I want you, as we close today and before we come to communion, to enter into what I call worship. When I played this song, the Kalakaua Orchestra learned this song. I loved it for its wicked bass lines. Afterwards, when I would go back to play rock music for a while, it seemed very tepid. For those of you who only like Beyoncé, this is a time to get deeper. Watch this.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
like Jesus on the cross, with his mangled, half-working body, he finished the piece. And it has riveted audiences globally ever since. And I believe when Handel entered heaven through one of those 12 pearly gates, I would like to believe that Jesus made sure that song was played and everybody stood to their feet with a rousing heavenly ovation because he took everything he had left to serve the Lord, even though he couldn't use one side of his body. What's your excuse? We are saved to serve with everything we have. We are not saved to sit.